As Mary hears our hearts, as she hears our intentions, and she wants to lend us her heart. One of the areas of our life, my husband Kurt and I have to tell you, I'm the one up here with the microphone, but the man behind that table up there is such a gift. He is such an absolute gift of grace. Yeah. I don't know if any of you read a story in the Catholic Sun. It's been quite a few years ago. It was in 2005, about a couple whose daughter had been raped and had become pregnant from that. And as she journeyed through that pregnancy, asking God, are you calling me to be a birth mother, or are you calling me to be a mom? That was our daughter, Adel. And as she journeyed through that pregnancy with more grace than 50 people, it was an amazing thing to see. And now our beautiful grandson, who was born very premature, Adel is like the poster child of, I don't know, grace. So many people were telling her, why are you doing this? Why are you going through it? You know, you could end it. Nobody expects you to give birth to this child. Or as they would say, it. And she said, one act of violence is not going to fix another act of violence. And she said her son literally saved her life, because most women who are brutalized in such a way have nothing but physical and emotional scars to show. She had the gift of new life. Now, being a diabetic from the time she was very little, this unplanned and very difficult pregnancy on top of a body that was healing, on top of preeclampsia and all of the other complications that a woman could go through, she went through every one of those. And when Zachary was born in an emergency cesarean to save his life, Adel was in congestive heart failure. Wow. 2004 was a rough year in the Carrick household. But when that precious little guy was born and we went to visit him in the NICU, it was phenomenal to see that grace. But one of the underlying things that we were going through as a family was that my husband, who worked for the DPS, for the Department of Public Safety, not only could he not prevent the attack on his daughter, they couldn't find the perpetrator. And because of all of the cases in our Phoenix Valley of rape, it got backburnered. It didn't matter. And he was very angry and he was very hurt. And he wanted to escape. And one of the things that he found himself doing one day was he was online looking for the name of a chum that he had gone to high school with. And as he's looking for his friend's name, instead of finding the name of his friend, the name of a woman popped up, a woman that he had dated back when he was 16. And with a couple of clicks of the mouse, they were connected. And both of them were in very dark places in their life. And 16 years old looked a lot nicer than in the life they were both living. And within just a few emails back and forth, they decided that they wanted to get out of the lives that they were in and start a new life together. And that was their plan. And so this went on for a number of months, and trying to figure out a way for that they could start this new life. Meanwhile, you can imagine, it was insane in our house. It was crazy in our house. But this one morning, January the 9th, I finally felt this strength in me that I had to say words that I had been hearing, and I would hear it in prayer time, and I thought, this cannot be coming from God. This cannot be coming from God. To hear the prayer, when I would say, Lord, give me the words to say to my husband, I heard this phrase, I've had enough, you need to leave. And I thought, that cannot be coming from God. And so I ignored it. I ignored it for a month every day. And finally on January the 9th, that morning, as I said to Kurt, is this the day that you're going to end this other relationship, you're going to come back to our marriage, and we're going to be a family? And he said, no, I said, then here's the thing. We're married. We have a sacrament that is a sacrament. We prepared for marriage in the church. We both know what the sacrament is. There was no impedance to the marriage. We're married, but I can't live like this. So, until you figure it out, I need you to leave. And he got up out of our room and he walked down the hallway. Our house isn't a huge house, but he said that day the hallway felt like it was about a mile long. He got to the end of the hallway to take a suitcase out of the closet, and he heard a woman's voice. And all she said was his name. She said, Kurt. And he turned around, and he said he knew it wasn't my voice. He knew it wasn't our daughter's voice. And then she continued, and her voice simply said, look around you. Look at your home. Look at the pictures on the wall. This is your family. This is where you belong. And he said in that instant, his heart was laid open, and he could see where he was headed was to death. And where he already had in his life was life. And he immediately had a 180-degree turnaround. Now, mind you, I'm in our room, not knowing that he's just had this encounter with this incredible woman, Mary. And he walks back into our room and he said, I choose you. I want to stay. I'm ending the relationship. It's over. And I'm thinking, what? And then the next morning, January the 10th, he took a sick day. He took a mental health day. And if anybody is here from DPS, well, he quit anyhow, but he took a day off the next day. And he said, I want to see what you do. I want to see what you do outside of the presentations that you go do. I don't know what you do in your ministry. And the very first phone call that came in was from Italy. And it was a gentleman by the name of Fabio. You can't make this stuff up. And he's on the phone, and he hands me the phone, and he said, it's Fabio from Italy for you. And I said, hello, buonasera. And he said, Julie, we would like you to come to Italy to sing for a concert, The World Sings of Mary, in April. And I said, we'll need 2 tickets. My husband will come with me. And we went there, and when we arrived in Scio, Italy, and before the concert began, we were in the green room getting ready to go out, and Fabio came in and he said, I have to ask you a question. Does November 15th last year have any significance in your life? And I said, yes, that was the day that my husband told me that he was going to divorce me. And he says, does January the 9th have a significance? And I said, yes, it does. That was the day that he said, no, we're staying together as a married couple. And he said, that was the day that Mama Mary told me it would be okay to call you. And he said, that whole time we've been praying for you, this community on the other side of the world in another language, a Marian community of Benedictine Oblates, 30,000 strong, were praying for us. He said, all I knew is I saw your name, I knew you had written a song called Mercy, and I knew that I had to pray for you because you were going to undergo a great sorrow.
Redemption, let the running waters carry sin.